are Cretaceous crabs. So these were crabs crawling around 70 million years ago in North Carolina when we had dinosaurs here in the state.
This is a big, mighty female.
So my lab is part of a museum, and I think the coolest part of this museum, the real core of what natural history museums are their collections. But most of those are off exhibit, so it can be hard to see and appreciate what they are and why they're important. So in this video, I want to show you them. I want to bring you down to the collections to meet some of our collections-based scientists and hear straight from them what collections are and why they're valuable cultural assets. Okay, first, let's start with ichthyology.
So I am Gabriella Hoag, and I'm the collections manager of fishes here at the Museum of Natural Sciences. And you are now in the fish collection. In this wonderful room, we have over a million specimens, closer to 1.5 million specimens. All of these specimens are kept in 70% ethanol. They're first preserved in a 10% formalin solution, and then we transfer them to 70% ethanol. And that maintains them for the long haul. In and of themselves, each of these fish specimens are beautiful. They're all unique. They all have these incredible features to them. But then when you add all of the data that accompanies them, where they were collected, how they were collected, who collected them, what the environmental factors were when they were collected, all of that is such a huge amount of metadata that's attached to every specimen. So we make all of that globally accessible because we know that each of these specimens has a story to tell. I can't tell that story. I can tell the story about some of them, but not all of them. But if we put the data out there, we know that globally and collaboratively, we can all tell the story about these specimens.
So a really big stuff doesn't fit in a jar. It has to go in these big stainless steel tanks. I'm Dr. Lily Hughes. I am the curator of ichthyology here at the North Carolina Museum of Natural Sciences, which means I study fish. So this is a tank of the Carolina red horse. This is a big, mighty female. These are in a group called red horses and suckers because they have these lips at the bottom of their mouth that they use to suck on the bottom. And you can actually tell most of the species apart by the different shapes on their lips, the different kind of structures they have on their lips. So this one is very special because this is going to be the holotype of the species. And that means it sort of bears a scientific name. All other specimens are sort of compared to it to see if they are most similar to the characteristics of a Carolina red horse. So when we are describing new species, we're not looking just in depth at that particular species or specimen. We're also looking at lots and lots and lots of different kinds of species that co-occur with it, maybe seem similar in some characteristics. So museums are really important sort of repositories of all of these different kinds of specimens that we can use to make these comparisons. So a lot of the ways that we conserve species are tied to the idea of a species and formal scientific recognition. So when this species gets a name, it will probably be eligible for more conservation protection.
Next up is paleontology. Now this collection is interesting because it's not based on a single group of organisms. Instead, it's any kind of fossilized life.
I'm Sean Moran. I'm the collections manager of paleontology here at the North Carolina Museum of Natural Sciences. I think the reason I like my job so much is it spans the gamut. So I get out, I do field work, I do research, and I get to see every single specimen that comes into this collection and record all of the data associated with that those specimens in our database. Yeah, so our paleo collections are scaled differently than a lot of collections. So in terms of taxonomy, I mean, we have everything from plants all the way up to dinosaurs and whales. In terms of size, we have microfossils that are barely visible to the naked eye, all the way up to complete dinosaur skeletons. So it's a really fun collection because the breadth is really wide, both in terms of scale, in size, and what animals and plants we're looking at in the fossil record. My research interests primarily lie in these 34 million year old mammals. Let's see, here's an example of a rhino that we collected this past summer. These are mammals that are living during one of the greatest shifts in climate of the past 66 million years since the extinction of the dinosaurs. One of the things I'm trying to look at is how these mammals are adapting to this climate event in terms of changing their body size, changing the shape and morphology of their teeth or ankle bones, changing diets. So our paleo collections are important so that we can look across these really large timescales and deep time and figuring out how species are evolving, going extinct, adapting to change across their landscapes, and tying that back to today's life. What can we glean from these fossil collections in the past that can inform us about the future of us, of our ecosystem, of our environment?
Finally, let's go down to mammals and meet Lisa Gatens. You might remember her from the bat fly video I published on this channel a few years ago. She's a researcher who took me out in the field while she was catching and tagging bats, so I could catch and film their bat fly ectoparasites.
I've been working with this collection for almost 26 years. In this row of cases, we have a lot of rodents, and well, rabbits here, rodents start down here, rodents go all the way down until where we pick up carnivores. We have our bat cases. Natural history specimens represent the species occurrence from a place in time. And as our collection shows, some of them are quite old, 100 years or so. So we can look at the specimens from different time points and look at changes in species composition in a particular place over time. And so this is part of the value of natural history collections. So our collection is not just skins. We keep skulls and other skeletal components as well as tissues. And I'm developing a key using skull characters to identify bats to species within this genus. There's currently not a way to identify bats based on skull characters. And this is more important now because the vast majority of bats that have been killed by white nose syndrome are bats in this genus. This is going to help us identify the actual impact of this disease on these species of bats. Why is it important for us to exist and to maintain research collections like this? Because we don't know what kinds of questions we might have about changes in distribution or ecology over time, and the information is in these specimens. We can take a few hair samples and look at isotopes or look for contaminants, toxins over time, for instance. And because they are permanent and because they're properly cared for and housed, the information that's here inherent in each of these individual specimens is still going to be available after hundreds of years.
Okay, so I hope you enjoyed that behind the scenes tour of some of our collections. And I hope after this, it's a little bit easier to understand why museums like this are important and why the collections are so valuable. Thanks for watching.